Hi, I'm Andrew Brown. Welcome to Real Time Music and Sound with Pure Data. In this episode, we're going to be looking at amplitude modulation. This diagram shows us the basic algorithm for amplitude modulation. If you saw the video in this series on ring modulation, you'll see that it's almost identical. The only difference is this here, which we'll get into in a second, this addition. First of all, let's just remind ourselves that in modulation, there's one oscillator which is modulating another. We usually call the oscillator that we're listening to the carrier oscillator, and then the oscillator which is doing the modulation, the modulator. So, basically, with amplitude modulation, the simple way to implement that, particularly in PD, is just to multiply the audio outputs from both, and that's exactly what we saw in ring modulation. So the difference that we're introducing in this video is this notion of a unipolar offset for the modulation oscillator. So we need to get into that in a little bit. So let's create a patch that starts to unpack what that's all about. I'm going to start by creating an oscillator, and we'll give it a particular frequency. Oh, actually, integer, there we go. And we need to always make sure we have a volume control and go out to our audio output. Create a volume amount, restrict that from 0 to 1 so we don't exceed our reasonable levels. And there we have our sine wave oscillator. Okay, now even though I have an oscilloscope here which can show us clearly that waveform, I'm going to do our trick in PD here of having an oscilloscope, in a sense, that's created using the array object. So we can create a new array. I'm going to call this $0 display. So the array has a name, and I'm going to make it 1,000 long and use polygons to draw. A little bit of explanation about why I've got this $0 at the beginning of the name. This will allow us to create a unique identifier for this array. PD will do that for us in the background, so that if we have several patches open, which each of which might have their own sort of display array, then the names won't conflict. This will become more apparent later when we've got some kind of a simple instrument and we want to create multiple instances of it and have several patches open and we don't want them to conflict. All right, so there's our array. And in order to get the audio data to display in that array, we use the tab right object, and we need to pass it the name of the array to which it's going to write that data. We have to send the output to the tab right, and it will do its thing when it gets a bang. We want it to draw multiple times, so we usually use a metro, which is like a metronome that sends out regular bang pulses, and we use a toggle to turn the metronome on and off. So if we turn that metronome on, turn the volume up, voila, we get our display. It may seem a little superfluous because we already have our oscilloscope showing, but one of the things that will happen in this video is that the waveforms will probably exceed the limits of the range. And I want to be able to show that over here. So let's see how that goes. So we have an oscilloscope. So let's put our modulating multiplier in here prior to our volume control. And we can, oops, so if, oh, actually, now before we do that, let's just go back to where we were. Because what I was trying to explain to you was the unipolar and bipolar waveform differences. Typically, waves like the one we're listening to now are bipolar. That is, in this sort of display, you can possibly even see it more easily in the oscilloscope. There's a zero line across here, and the values are going up to one and down to negative one. So we call this bipolar because it's going both up and down from the zero line. When we have a unipolar waveform, it's going to go from zero just in one direction. So just, for example, in a positive direction. So the range will be from zero to one, rather than from negative one to one. In order to create an oscillator that is like that, we need to do a little bit of math. One of the simplest things we can do is just add one to all of the samples. If we do that, we now get that array that we wanted. But you may notice that we're only at 50% volume, and it's already showing, filling up that particular array there. And if we keep going, we start to exceed the volume. We get some distortion because the audio output will be clipping all of those things. So to get our full amplitude range in this area here, we're going to not only offset it by one, but we will also divide it by two, just to make it be half as large. So now you can see we can get all the way up to one, and it fills the range from zero to one. So this is how we've constructed a unipolar oscillator from the standard oscillator, which is bipolar by default. I'm going to position that over here as our modulating oscillator, and then create another oscillator over here, which we're going to leave in its normal unipolar fashion. And then we can go back and insert our multiplication for our amplitude modulation. So these two oscillators, the amplitude of each of them will be modulated. We also should make sure we can set a frequency for this first oscillator. So do that. Get the kind of ring modulation that we were getting back in the ring modulation. So let's talk a little bit about amplitude modulation. When both of these oscillators are in the audio spectra, like they are now, 130 Hz, 337 Hz, then we usually refer to this as ring modulation. It's more typical for amplitude modulation to think about effect. I'm just going to change that from so the range is a bit more sensible. We usually think about this as having a very low frequency rather than a high frequency. So you probably heard of the term a low frequency oscillator, an LFO. It's just an oscillator that goes very slow. So in this case, we're going at 0.7 Hz, which is pretty low. And then turn the volume up. You can see that what's happening is it's changing the overall volume or amplitude of this first oscillator. You can see that doesn't matter what the frequency of that one is. In musical terms, we would call this a tremolo. Usually a little bit faster than that. And if we want to change the amount of tremolo, we can insert a volume control in here so that we can control the level of the modulating oscillator. By default, it was just at maximum amplitude. So then you can see we can increase the amount of effect that we're having in that way. So in a sense, the only difference between this sort of straightforward tremolo and the ring modulation, which has a big timbral effect, is that we move the modulating oscillator's frequency up until eventually it becomes so fast. So fast that we can't hear the individual ups and downs, and we now it all fuses together into a timbral effect. So when basically each of these frequencies are in the audio range, then that's what's going on there. And the ratio between these two frequencies determines the kind of character in terms of the timbral character of what's going on. Okay, so amplitude modulation, with this acting at a low frequency and as an LFO, then it creates tremolo, and then once this moves into the audio spectra, the second modulating oscillator, then we get the kind of timbral effect on what's going on. A thing that we can talk about now is another kind of oscillator. For the minute, I'm just going to create one here. There's an oscillator, pH, called a phaser in PD. And if I connect the phaser directly to the tab right and give it a frequency, you'll see, we can't hear it at the moment because it's not connected to the output, you'll see that the waveform is a triangular kind of waveform. But what you'll also notice, now that we have our newfound understanding of unipolar and bipolar waveforms, that this is actually by default a unipolar wave. It starts at zero and it's going up to one as a maximum. So if we really want to use the phaser as a sawtooth waveform, we need to, in a sense, do the opposite of what we did here, which was we need to convert this into a unipolar waveform. So let's think about how to do that. We need it to go over a bigger range. So what we can do to make it go over a larger range is to multiply it, in this case by 2. Notice I'm using multiply tilde because it's an audio signal. If we look and see what that does. Okay, so we've multiplied the waveform. It's now twice as large as it was, but you can see it's now going from 0 up to 2. What we want to do is to make it go from negative 1 to 1, so we need to offset it. We can do that by saying minus tilde 1. And voila, we now have a sawtooth waveform, a bipolar sawtooth waveform, just like we need for sort of sound synthesis in the normal case, based on our phaser. So let's see what happens if we actually introduce that into the modulation process. So let's replace our original sine wave oscillator with our sawtooth and have a listen. So we can see that we've got our sawtooth appearing over here. Let's also connect it to there so we can see it in both places. Okay, so that's all good. Now if we introduce some low frequency oscillation, then we get a kind of tremolo effect we were talking about before. Now if we continue to increase the frequency of this modulating oscillator up into the audio range, you can hear we're having a timbral effect. We get quite an interesting waveform that goes through and changes quite dramatically at times. So we've introduced quite a timbral variation as we go. If we want to go one step further, we could replace the modulator with a phaser. Now we know that over here on this modulating side, we're looking for a unipolar oscillator, and we know that the phaser is already unipolar, so we can replace all of that machinery there with another phaser object. Connect the frequency up, then move that there. So now what we're doing is we're modulating one sawtooth wave with another sawtooth wave. So let's have a listen. So there's a fairly low frequency, 2 hertz. Increase that frequency. We're getting quite a noisy, rich harmonic spectra. So we can hear that we're getting quite a rich spectra out of some fairly simple oscillating components. In this case, the phaser, because the phaser is already reasonably rich. When we modulate the phaser, we get an even richer spectra as we go. So give that a go, and I will see you in the next video.